my hopes, and I can't let you go. You are the one who, you are the one who makes me feel so real. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, what am I supposed to do? Oh, what am I supposed to do, baby, when I'm so hooked up on you? Then I realize, oh, I realize that you are somebody else's guy. Oh, yeah. Why you wanna do this to me, boy?
And realize that you're somebody else's guy. stuff. Somebody else's guy. What am I supposed to do when I'm hooked so on you? They realize I'm somebody else's guy. Isn't that something? I think Gwen Guthrie should have came on by and gave her a little advice such as this.
It would make my day. don't need you. Oh, no.
So here we go, chapter 17. From Mama's Bed to Mama's Songs. I grew to hate Mama's bed because whenever Daddy was gone, she wanted me to sleep with her. When I did sleep with her, after she thought I'd gone to sleep, she'd cry in despair of her situation with him. I couldn't help but hear it. This would really hurt me, feeling helpless and unable to comfort her. I felt the best way for me to handle it was to play possum and remain asleep. I felt Mama was silly for wasting her tears. I always knew my mother was a beautiful woman, but she allowed Daddy to brainwash her into thinking no one else would care. He'd say things like, "No one's going to want you with all of your children." She was lonely, and I knew that. After all, I was there listening to her fears, prayers, and tears. Why was she crying in front of me? I despised her so much, but at the time, I hid that fact. Instead, I begged her to let me sleep with my brothers. She'd always reply, "You're a little girl, Bunny." Of course, I knew that, but it was much better than being in her room to me. She'd finish with, "I want you to have your own room someday, but until then, you can sleep with me." This was her way of justifying the reason I should be in her room. She presented it to me like it was a privilege, but I didn't feel that way at all. Then she tried to guilt me into agreeing and used some reverse psychology by saying, "Your mama's only girl and mama's girl too. Don't you like sharing a room with your mother? or she comfort me and give me hope by saying, maybe this time the baby will be a little girl and you can share a room with her. Meanwhile, mama likes sharing her room with you. I listened, but I wasn't sold on the idea at all. When my plea to her failed, I then resulted in blaming my reasoning on Bobby's nightmares and the fact that he feared sleeping alone. But mama, Bobby's scared. I could be there to comfort him, I'd say. Now I knew she couldn't deny that Bobby would often wake up screaming about the mummy trying to get him, but she had a good rebuttal for that one too. Bobby doesn't sleep alone, she said. Uncle James is in there with him, and I'm sure he knows what to do. She just wasn't buying my excuse. Bobby's a boy, and he has brothers. Finally, she realized there must have been another reason I didn't want to be in there, and she gave me an expression that let me know I'd sadden her. So now she was going to get me with guilt. Why are you saying these things? Don't you like to sleep with your mother? You hurt my feelings. I love sleeping with you. Oh, boy. Now I'd have to clean it up by assuring her, it's not that, Mama. I do want to sleep with you. I'm just worried about Bobby. However, the real fact was it bothered me when Mama cried, and I definitely hated hearing her talk about Daddy to my aunts on the phone. I didn't want to think about what was happening when he wasn't around. For the most part, I managed not to until I'd hear her cry. I would affirm that Daddy was around and still, it would affirm that Daddy was around and still in our lives, and that's what I hated most. Of course, I did want my own room, but there wasn't enough room for that. So until then, I'd rather sleep with my brothers. Her tears had entangled with the memory of sleeping in her bed, and I couldn't separate them one from another. The memory wasn't all bad, though. There was a good side of the coin. However, several years would progress before my appreciation for it would settle in. The good part was being able to observe Mama's prayers, watching her fall to her knees and witness the joy she received from it. And then she'd rise from her knees, holding her head up high and proud. Even as a young child, this would give me hope, and I knew where she was getting this strength from. She'd have confidence and such peace. Mama was teaching me that prayer worked and just where to go for all that I needed. Also in her room, she'd write songs to encourage herself. God always put in songs in her heart, and she'd go around singing them throughout the day. I will keep you in perfect peace if you keep your mind stay on me. If you keep your mind stay on me. She may have forgotten. I've had to remind her, but that song is still in my spirit to this day. You never know when you're creating a memory for someone else that will last forever. This woman fueled our legacy because eventually we followed right after her. We began to write little melodies. Our words might not have made much sense. We were young, but we had the harmony. The first song we wrote together was Hallelujah, Jesus, Buckle My Shoe. We showed it to Mama, and she was so proud of us. She laughed at our words, but she was amazed with our harmonies. She had us sing the song to Uncle James. He was amazed as well and began to work with us. He taught me a new song to sing. It was a song already written, but he arranged and titled, Now I Belong to Jesus. I'll never forget this song. I sang it at every church service I was allowed. I was still singing solo, but Mama continued teaching us as a group. She'd rehearse us every day. I was so into it, and I'd rehearse the boys even when she was gone. It was hard for me to do. They were so active, and I couldn't keep them in one place. Mama knew just what to do, though. She promised us little treats if we learned our parts. She even challenged us to learn songs that we would hear on television shows. There were songs that stayed with me and Bobby and helped form melodies we'd write in the future. It was all in fun and we enjoyed every bit of it. Music was the happy side of our troubles. Mama was venturing out now that we were older, and she decided to join her brother's group. The group consisted of Mildred Hammond, Fred Hammond's mother, Ruth O'Keefe, Bernard Hayden, Dietrich Hayden's father, Mama and Uncle James. They were singing at all the church services in Detroit. They even performed at out-of-town engagements. My Uncle Bill was now a full-time minister at the church. The group would travel with him as he preached. Mama would make the engagements in town, but it was still hard for her to travel out of town. Nonetheless, that was okay because she'd also sing with us. Her real dreams were in her children. Chapter 18. Why would Daddy do that to me? Oh, Lord. Ooh. All right. My Uncle Bill's ministry was growing. He was offered a position as pastor in Grand Rapids. When he visited the city and saw the church, he liked it. He felt it was the Lord's will that he should be there. So he packed up everything, gathered his family, and moved there. This was a sad time for me. Not only did I no longer have my grandma, but Uncle Bill was leaving Detroit too. I was very close to my uncle and my grandma. I loved them dearly, and I knew they loved me. Now that they had both gone so far away, I felt deserted and vulnerable because they were my only means of protection from the abuse we experienced. Both Grand Rapids, Michigan, and California seemed so far away. It felt like they lived in another world. However, when Uncle Bill left, he promised me he'd come back to get me in the summer. He said when Grandma comes back to Detroit to visit, he'd drive down to pick us up. He gave me his promise, and that really made me feel better, as he was known to be a true man of his word. At home, I was Mama's little helper, and I learned quickly because there were now 6 children in the house. She worked hard, always washing and cooking. The boys were active, always into something. Bobby and I, being the oldest, had responsibilities. We'd pin diapers on the babies, put on rubber pants, wash diapers in the tub, and wring them out by hand. I really had no time to be Mama's baby. I had to be a big girl now, and that I was. Hey, Shady, how you doing? My mama would praise me and talk about how independent I was. I was her only girl, and even though I wanted a sister badly, being the only girl did have its privileges. It felt good that my brothers loved and depended on me. But then there was those times where I wanted to just be a little girl. Being the second mama would become unbearable, so I was always looking for a way to escape from the house. Aunt Ernestine would come and get me to go to her house. At her house, I could just be a little girl and play with my cousin Joni. Joni had a strong, sometimes cruel personality. She was always bossing us around, whereas I had a timid spirit, and her cruel behavior would intimidate me. It would just hurt my feelings, but I didn't want to leave. Joni was the only female I had to play with, and I liked having her around. She wouldn't let anyone else hurt me. She'd be there in a hurry to fight my battles for me. It was now time for Mama to have the baby, and the doctor told her it would be any day. As a result, Daddy was at the house much more often. She let him right back in, and it became business as usual. He was coming into our bedroom to kiss us goodnight, but now his target was me. Mama's water broke and she went into labor. It's time, she said. My pains are 5 minutes apart. Daddy was at work. He only had a few more hours there and he'd be home. He knew any time now Mama would have the baby. The day was finally came and we were so excited. We felt close to the baby. We were ready to see this little one. Mama would let each of us feel the baby moving around in her stomach. She'd allowed us to put our face on her belly. Then we'd talk to it. I'd say, "Hi, little sister." Whereas Bobby would say, "Hey, little brother." In those days, ultrasounds weren't invented, so there was no way of knowing if it was a boy or a girl. We were all simply guessing as to what the baby was going to be. We were ready for the new baby, whatever it was going to be, and now it was finally time. Mama's labor pains got harder and harder, and they were coming sooner. She was trying to wait for Daddy to come home, but Mommy couldn't wait any longer. "Go next door and ask Miss Pryor to let you use the phone," she cried. "You got to call Aunt Ernestine to come and take me to the hospital. Tell your aunt my water broke and I'm ready to go to the hospital now." Mama seemed to be in so much pain as she held her stomach and panted. Bobby and I jetted out the front door. We were so wound up, we were running into each other as we raced each other to the house next door. "I'll tell her," I yelled. "No, I'll tell her," screamed Bobby. When we got there, Miss Pryor was sitting with her children on the porch. Out of breath from running around, I panted, "Can we use your phone? We need to call our aunt," added Bobby. And then we simultaneously chimed in, "Our mama, she's getting ready to have the baby." Miss Pryor let us into the house on the phone, and then she went to tell Mama that we could stay with her until Daddy got home. My aunt and uncle came and they all raced off to the hospital. It would be late when Daddy got home, so Miss Pryor put us to bed. She left a note at our house telling Daddy that Mama was in the hospital. She told him he could pick us up at her house. I knew when Daddy arrived because I heard him knock on the door. Right then, I felt my stomach turning and knotting up as I heard Miss Pryor telling him we were asleep. She told him we could stay the night and she'd send us home in the morning. He'd already been home, read the note, and been to the hospital to see Mama. He told Miss Pryor that Mama had another boy and now she was resting. He was tired and wanted to take us home then. He said he really didn't want to wake up early in the morning to let us in. When I heard her come into the room to get us, I pretended to be asleep. My thoughts were, if Daddy thought we were asleep, he'd change his mind and let us stay. I didn't want to go home with Daddy. And my stomach was hurting with fear. I knew what he was going to do. It's what he always did when Mama was gone. However, Miss Pryor got us up and we prepared to go home. Daddy told us that we had a new baby brother. After we got home, we all went to our rooms. I helped Mark and Elle get into bed, laid in bed with them, and we all fell back asleep. Daddy waited until we were asleep, then came into our bedroom. I could smell the scent of his body as I felt his hands on me. I kept my eyes shut, thinking he was going to do what he always do, touch me in my private places and leave. However, this time he picked me up, carried me into Mama's bedroom, put me on her bed, and got into bed with me. He went a step further this time. I was scared to death, but I didn't want to cry. He was completely naked as he removed my PJs. Then he began kissing me. He kissed me as if I were a grown woman, putting his tongue in my mouth. He felt all over my body. Y'all. I guess I gotta read this, huh? This is getting really too deep, but let me just do this. Let me get my mind straight for this. I'm just gonna play a quick song. All right.
Against my window pane is slowly driving me insane. Boy, I'm going down. I'm going down. 'Cause you ain't around. Baby, my whole life. So down, sleep don't come easy. Boy, please believe me, since you've been gone, everything's going wrong. Why'd you have to say goodbye? Look what you've done to me. I can't stop these tears from falling from my eyes. Oh, baby, I'm going down.
Okay, I'm back. I'm back. Here we go. All right. However, this time he picked me up, carried me into Mama's bedroom, put me in her bed, and got into bed with me. He went a step further this time. I was scared to death, but I didn't want to cry. He was completely naked as he removed my PJs. Then he began kissing me. He kissed me as if I were a grown woman, putting his tongue in my mouth. He felt all over my body. As he touched my breasts, he was very rough. They were tender and I cringed. He saw that he was hurting me, so he kept apologizing for the pain. Daddy, sorry. Daddy won't hurt you. Now just relax. Suddenly, the rubbing on me stopped. He wasn't just touching me anymore. He entered me, leaving me helpless, hopeless, and not knowing what to do. I didn't know how to feel about it. I just knew my father was wrong. I was only 9 years old. I was frightened and so ashamed. I felt so dirty, so unclean, like a baby whining for her mother. I cried from within. I was too afraid to show my tears. I didn't want him to see me cry. Moreover, I was afraid of what his reaction might be. Daddy said nothing to me. He didn't even say for me not to tell anyone. He really didn't have to, because he'd already put that fear in me. He wasn't mean in his approach in pursuing me. That isn't where he hurt me. There was no forcing me. I went willingly. I couldn't push him away. I was afraid. After all, he was my daddy. It was as if my spirit had left my body, floating to the top of the ceiling, watching everything that was happening to me. It felt like I was dead in my body, as Daddy took me like his woman. I didn't feel it. I was numb and truly didn't understand why he was there with me. I could do nothing but lay there and do whatever he wanted me to. In my mind, I was praying for the moment that he'd stop. It seemed like it took forever for him to get through. After he was done, he fell asleep. I would just lay there awake, too afraid to get up and leave. I felt the wetness between my legs and didn't understand what it was. I wondered, why would Daddy do these things to me? While Mama was in the hospital, he'd routinely bring me to his bed after the boys were asleep and do the same things over and over again. Then before the morning would come, he'd sneak me back in the room before the boys would wake up. I had become Daddy's woman. I didn't dare tell Mama. Neither could I tell anyone else. It was Daddy's secret, and it had gotten deeper now, much deeper than it ever was before. We lived in the same house as mother, father, and daughter. Only now, I wasn't just Daddy's daughter. I was his woman. He hurt and bruised my spirit in a way destining my life ahead of me. He took away my choice of whom I wanted to share my virginity with and robbed me of my purity. In my heart, I was now tainted. He brought a curse on my life that I'd carry with me until the day God would set me free. It was a curse that would go down through the generations that my children and my children's children would have to carry and see. I didn't understand it then, how it would follow me. However, it was a curse deep rooted down within my life. Children would be born into this, never understanding where the curse came from. However, we were the kept ones. No matter how bleak or daring it may look,
God had a plan for me. I just didn't know it then. Satan wanted to destroy my growth, but God said not so. What a nasty son of a bitch. That is just so damn demonic. How is your wife giving birth to baby number 7 and you... You would think Adeline would have left him the first time he beat her ass. Okay, so maybe not the first time. How about the 10th time he beat ass? How about her leaving when all that time she thought he was driving across country, but he living a couple of blocks away with another woman, and both of them were pregnant twice at the same time? You think she would have left him then? You think she would have left him when he came home looking like a mummy and got his ass jumped because he was messing with the daughter of that woman? That doesn't make you leave either. I'm just not getting, I don't understand her mentality of staying married until death do you part. I tried to make sense of it the last book reading. I don't get it. Why would you let him back in the house when he screwing Miss Vicky across the alley? But I guess if you got 6 children and you're pregnant, a little bit of help is better than none. I don't know. Miss Adeline is still alive today. I sure enough wish I can call her and just ask her questions. For real. I got questions. She is 87 years old. I'm just thankful that I didn't have no weird, stupid mother. My mother would never stood for any of that. Chapter 19, Discipline. Mama had come home on our moving day with another baby boy, and she named him James Curtis. So when James, Janet Jackson's first husband, was being born, their daddy was raping his 9-year-old sister. This time, Daddy found the house he was moving us into. Now that Mama had a new baby, Daddy was back to living with us again. The house was new, the baby was new, but Daddy was the same old Daddy. He had a new secret relationship with me. However, he was meaner than ever to my brothers. This is what I don't get. Here, this woman stayed in prayer, believed in God. God was going to deliver. God is all she needed. God was always going to see him through. She praying and she worshiping, going to church, going to church, going to church. And you mean to tell me the Lord don't tell you that your husband is fucking your daughter? He don't tell you none of that. He don't throw you no hint. You just clueless. I'm sorry. Let me go on. As for Bobby and Tommy, Daddy was always breaking their spirit. He constantly picked on Bobby, always slapping him around for the least little thing he did. He would whoop him so bad that Mama had to jump in. Then she'd end up taking the whooping from Daddy. It was as if he hated Bobby, and Bobby hated him. However, Daddy seemed to be closer to the new baby, James, more than he was with any of his children. He bonded with him right from the start. He would tell us how James looked like his brother, Spurplier. He'd carry him around the house and call him Jimmy James. He'd sing little songs to him, get up in the morning with him, and feed him. He did things with him that he never did with his other children. James was definitely Daddy's boy. Meanwhile, Bobby watched all of this with despise and at the age of 8 started acting out. Since Daddy was so mean to Bobby, Bobby was mean to his younger brothers, especially Tommy, and he didn't seem to like James at all. He resented Daddy giving James attention and then mistreating the rest of us. Before Mama had the baby, Bobby wanted a brother. He was looking forward to the baby, but now that the baby was here and Daddy was paying James so much attention, Bobby didn't care about the baby. Whenever he tried to get close to his baby brother, James, Daddy would push him away. So Bobby stayed his distance from James. Daddy was home, didn't have a job, and stayed around the house. He'd always say to us, "This house will be in order." Therefore, he was constantly giving us work to do. He deliberately gave us work that we didn't know how to do. Furthermore, he'd never show us how to do it. He'd just instruct us that it had to be done. Then he'd turn around and whoop us for not doing it right. Mama would try to instruct us, but he'd interfere and make her stop. As a result, everything we learned to do was out of fear. We didn't do it because we loved our daddy. We did it because we didn't want to whoop him. We were afraid, so we tried to do our best. Even when we thought we'd done our best, he found something wrong with it. It was like he went looking for something to punish us for. We'd look up and the drawers would be out of the dresser and the clothes thrown on the floor. On top of that, he'd take the covers off the bed and throw them across the room. Maybe he thought we were in the army. Whatever it was, we thought he'd gone mad. He'd come in our room and always find one thing out of place, then go and destroy our whole room. So you see this man. Never mind. Adeline's starting to piss me the fuck off. His disciplines were never fair, and Mama knew this. She'd jump in when she couldn't take anymore and try to stop him. However, I didn't get as many beatings from Daddy as the boys did. He'd slap me every now and then, but my abuse from Daddy was sexual. I whoop the boys, but I'm fucking you, girl. That's your punishment. On the other hand, he was fond of James, though. He could hardly cry before Daddy would be picking him up. As we grew older, so did the mental, physical, and sexual abuse in our home. There were no more babysitters for Daddy to fondle. He was the permanent babysitter, and I was the one being fondled. It would be nothing for him to come into the kitchen while I was washing dishes and rub up against me. I was miserable with Daddy touching me. However, I began to notice Daddy's attitude change. Whereas he'd be nicer towards Mama and my brothers whenever he was making sexual advances toward me. His focus would be more on me than on abusing them. And in a twisted way, I eventually felt that his sexually abusing me was saving the rest of my family. I felt if I had to take the abuse, at least I was making the burden lighter for them. This is so sick. I truly look forward to the days Aunt Ernestine will come and take me with her. It was my getaway, a chance for me to take a breath and just relax. I'd be with a real family, and I could see how it's really supposed to be. My aunt and uncle were a husband and wife who loved the Lord and prayed together every day. I witnessed their discipline with their children, and it was nothing like ours. It was done out of love. There was still fear. I mean, what child wants to be hit? However, there was a difference in the style and intent of the discipline. I wanted so badly to tell my aunt what I was going through. Maybe I could stay with her. Nevertheless, I said nothing. I merely enjoyed the little time I had away. On the other hand, Bobby and the rest of the boys didn't have a getaway. They had to stay with Mama and Daddy. Bobby was so miserable too, and I knew it. My poor little brother Bobby seldom ever smiled. Chapter 20, title is We Are Performing. Uncle Bill was now the president for the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World. Uncle James became the minister of music for the assembly. The Pentecostal churches united every year for the conventions, and each year it would be held in a different city. My mama found it hard to travel with her gospel group, but she'd make it to the convention. At home, she was rehearsing with her children. The Debarge children were going to sing. She saw us going places and one day becoming famous. Every church that invited Mama to sing, she'd feature us. At the time, our group consisted of Bobby, Tommy, Randy, Mark, and myself. Since I was already singing solos, Mama didn't feature me in the group. Bobby and Tommy were the stars. She taught me well, and I was singing everywhere. I made glee club in school, and all of my teachers knew I was a singer. Mama had taught me another song to sing at church called Somebody's Bigger Than You and I. The church we attended would often call on me to sing it. When I wasn't singing solo, I was singing in our group. Most of the time, Mama would plan it where the congregation would hear all three of us. She'd written a song called Let Me Tell You About My Jesus. Again, she taught it to her children. We'd sing it along with a song she arranged for us called Little David, Play on Your Harp. Obviously, we sang at many churches in the city. Before you knew it, we were doing the gospel radio stations in Detroit. Every Sunday morning, Mama would wake us up early and we hit the radio stations before church. Tommy was the one that Mama featured in the group. He was the boldest of the boys. She'd hand him the microphone and he'd boldly step out in front of the group and lead us. Although he was tongue-tied, he sounded cute. Everybody loved it. He had so many fans because he was young and very confident. Bobby would tease him, calling him a big show-off. However, this didn't dampen Tommy's spirit. He did what came naturally even more. Bobby was always the shy one. He was more comfortable singing in the background. Whenever he had to lead, he was bashful. As a result, he only had one line to the song. We loved music. It was our life. It was the other side of the darkness that we lived at home. Moreover, it made us happy. It was the only escape we had. Greater Grace was one of the churches we'd often sang at. It was where Uncle Bill would often go to preach. David Ellis was the pastor of the church, and he was one of Uncle Bill's best friends. Although David Ellis wasn't really our uncle, you couldn't tell us that. We all affectionately called him Uncle David. his children also sang, and we were in programs together throughout the city. The thought danced in my heart. This year, when Grandma comes back, it'll be completely different. She and I will go to Grand Rapids because Uncle Bill had a church there and she'd never seen it. She was proud of her son and wanted to visit his church. I knew Grandma would be proud of us too. We were following in her children's footsteps. We'd made a name for us in the city. Now we were more than just the children with a white daddy and a black mama. Chapter 21, Grandma Saves the Day. Uncle Bill was coming from Grand Rapids to pick us up, and Grandma and I were patiently waiting to leave Detroit. She'd already let Mama know I was going with her, and I was so happy to escape the madness at home. At this point, Mama no longer shared her problems at home with her mother because she didn't want her to worry. In addition to that, she wanted me to follow suit. However, no one had to tell Grandma my mother's business. There were just some things she had an intuition about. It was either her instinct or God-given insight, but either way, I believe she knew something wasn't right. See what I'm saying? Grandma would take me to church with her and then over to my aunt and uncle's house. Every once in a while, another cousin would come along, but I was always with her. She'd sneak notes home addressed to Mama away from Daddy's eyes, telling her to have me ready. I was even prohibited from telling my brothers I was going with her. I knew that in the event I did manage to let it slip out, she wouldn't take me. She and I were inseparable when she was in town, and her visits were always a pleasure. Daddy was always on his best behavior when she was there, and this definitely made the household bearable. I'd have told Grandma. The day I longed anticipated had finally arrived, and Grandma sent me home with the infamous note for Mama to have my summer clothes packed for the summer. I could tell Mama wasn't too fond of me going, and I knew it was because she needed me at home. I was a great help to her around the house, but now I'd be gone the whole summer. Nevertheless, she complied with Grandma's request in spite of her own feelings about it. She knew Grandma was sickly and wanted to make her happy while she was around because tomorrow wasn't promised. The time was soon approaching for her to return to Los Angeles, and none of us would be seeing her for a while. I was young and didn't realize the extent of her illness. I thought it was a foreshadowing in the last chapter when she mentioned this year when Grandma comes back, it'll be completely different. I had a foreshadowing thought that Grandma wasn't going to make it back for the summer. So let's see. I was young and didn't realize the extent of her illness. All I knew was that I wanted to be with her as much as possible because it got me away from home. When I was with her was the only time I found the freedom to simply be a little girl. And that was so important to my childhood. When I was with her, I didn't have to bear the pressure of being the eldest of so many siblings. She could focus on me without dividing her attention. The turmoil at home could be tucked away in the pocket of my memory bank for now, and that felt awesome. I could relax and enjoy myself every day. However, every night when I'd kneel to say my prayers, I found it inevitable for my mind to set in on my brothers, especially Bobby. I'd extend my prayers for them because I knew they were miserable. Even though I was grateful to be blessed in this respect, I'm going to read it just like it's written. Even though I was grateful to be blessed in this respect, I felt guilty because knew they weren't as fortunate to be able to get away. All I could do was pray for them, to have a great summer. Before leaving Detroit, I was carefully instructed by Mama not to tell her business and not to cause any problems for Grandma. So quite naturally, when Grandma would notice me drifting off in thought, she'd attempt to pry, but it was best that I kept my thoughts to myself for this reason. Uncle Bill came in town, and we were happy to see him, very much ready to go. It took us 2 hours to get there, but to me, it seemed like forever. We arrived late while everyone was sleeping. Therefore, I was unable to see my cousins until the morning. However, we all went to Aunt Mamie's house the next day. When we arrived, my cousins were all there waiting to see Grandma, but my presence was an added bonus because they had no idea I was coming. That Saturday, we went to the church picnic where each family brought a dish. I remember the details like it was yesterday. Aunt Mamie made potato salad and baked beans, and we had so much fun running, laughing, and playing together. The grown-ups picked teams and played baseball as the children watched and cheered. I remember suddenly turning my attention to Grandma, who didn't seem to be herself. As a result, a sense of worry overcame me because I didn't want anything to happen to her. In many ways, she was my heroine. More importantly, we were close and I loved her so much. She understood what I wasn't saying. Furthermore, we had a complete nonverbal communication which took place between us that comforted me so much. Things like a simple smile, a stroke of my hair, or when I leaned my head against her arm, she'd embrace me because she knew I needed it. Her mere presence breathed nonverbal love that was sometimes more powerful than words. I wanted for her to be well, to continue to come and visit and take me away. After the picnic was over, the children helped bring the leftover food in the house. I happened to overhear Uncle Bill and Aunt Mamie talking. This may be the last summer we have with Mama. She doesn't seem to be getting any better, Uncle Bill said. My grandmother's heart was bad, and her diabetes was getting worse. I knew she was sick, but never did I think of my grandmother dying. When she didn't appear to be herself, I simply thought she was tired. I began to worry more and more, helping Grandma out the best I could as the summer flew by fast. I was now 1 week away from having to return to Detroit. Uncle Bill would be driving me back after the big church revival. Our family in Detroit came to Grand Rapids for the revival and to see Grandma. In addition, Bethel Pentecostal Church was celebrating their new pastor, my Uncle Bill. Uncle James was the choir director, and the choir was in concert that weekend. This was a big event, and Uncle Bill asked me to sing. Many people sang before me as I waited ever so patiently. The service was long, and I thought my uncle had maybe forgotten about me. Finally, my uncle got up to announce the preacher for the night. He suddenly says, "I have a special treat for you tonight. My niece, Bunny Debarge, is here visiting, and I want her to sing for us tonight." While looking out into the audience, he asks, "Bunny, where are you?" I stood up and started walking towards the pulpit of that little church. It was packed, but on that night, it was such a long walk. When I finally got there, he hugged me and whispered, "Let the Lord use you, Bunny." Then I closed my eyes and began to sing. I sang from the depths of my soul. I was sincere like never before. I paid attention to the words as I sang them. For some reason on that night, the words I sang were personal, especially for me. The anointing came upon me, and I could truly feel Jesus. The congregation felt Jesus too. When I opened my eyes, I could see the saints were in tears, praising the Lord. It was no longer just a song I'd sing to get praise. The song entitled, "Somebody Bigger Than You and I," had become my praise. It became my praise I'd used to walk it out through the various trials in my life. I was going through something as a child, and God was saying to me, He was bigger than everything I was going through. I sang the lyrics with all my heart. When I am lonely, filled with despair, who gives me courage to go on from there? And who gives me hope that will never die? Somebody bigger than you and I. Who lights my way when the road gets dark? Keeps me company and with love to guide me. He'll walk beside you just like He walks with me. When I finished my song that night for the first time, I felt the anointing of God. He's a good God, and I took Him at His word. It was the beginning of me personally knowing Him for myself. I was working in my calling. I didn't know it then, but Uncle Bill did. He saw who I was and where I was supposed to be. From that day on, He invested in me. He was the one, along with Mama and Uncle James, to prepare me for kingdom work. He took me everywhere with Him that summer to sing as He preached. He'd even get high in the spirit during the song, stand up and sing it with me. Each church would be in tears from the anointing of the song. My mama was so proud of me. She and Uncle Bill would remind me all the time that God was using me. Don't play with God. You have to live the life He sets before you, she'd say. The anointing. Y'all know that God is using His child. Y'all know all of this, but y'all don't know that daddy's fucking her. I'd listen attentively to what my grandma and her family would say about the Lord. I wanted to know God because I felt His realness in my life. I loved Grand Rapids and wanted to stay there. I loved living at Aunt Mamie's house, and I couldn't bear the thought of going back home. It was the best summer I ever had. I wish it never had to end. Grandma would soon be leaving, and Aunt Mamie had already told me not to ask Grandma to go back with her. She knew this would worry her and knew my grandma would worry about the fact that I'd asked her. Moreover, she knew Grandma would try to find some kind of way to take me back with her if she could. Since I didn't want to worry Grandma, I asked Aunt Mamie, "Can I stay with you, Aunt Mamie? Will you ask Mama if it would be all right?" Aunt Mamie looked at me and said, "What would your mother do without her only girl, Bunny? Your mother loves her little girl, and it would hurt her to think her only daughter doesn't want to come home to her." I reasoned, "Oh, Aunt Mamie, she can have another girl. Then I won't be her only daughter. She'll have a new one." Aunt Mamie smiled at me before replying, "All your mother brings into this world are boys, and I don't think God's going to give Edeline no more girls. It doesn't seem like it anyway. For God's sake, let's not wish another baby on her. And if she did have another girl, it wouldn't be like her little Bunny." At this point, I was speechless. Not knowing what else to say, I became very sad. Seeing the look of sadness over my face, Aunt Mamie lifted my spirit with, "Maybe your mom will allow you to come and spend the summers with us. I'll ask her that." Then she went on to question me about what was really going on at home with Mama and Daddy. I told her some things, but I still didn't feel I could trust her yet with the secret I was keeping about Daddy and me. Maybe if I was staying with her, I would, but not now. I still had to go back home. What a position to be in as a little girl, a child. The summer ended and it was time for school. Grandma had left for California, but before she left, I heard her tell Aunt Mamie to keep an eye on me. If something happened to her and she couldn't get back to see us, she wanted to feel comfortable knowing I was taken care of. Aunt Mamie told her nothing was going to happen to her and we'd all see her again. However, she promised her that she'd keep an eye on me. Grandma felt something wasn't right with me at home, but just didn't know what it was. She questioned me the whole time I was with her, but I told her nothing. Grandma wasn't herself, and Mama had already warned me not to tell her business. God knew that if Grandma knew my secret, it would have killed her. After I'd said my goodbyes to all my cousins in Grand Rapids, Aunt Mamie helped me pack my clothes. Uncle Bill picked me up the next morning and drove me until it was almost evening. However, I didn't return to the house we used to live in. Mama and Daddy had now moved into a new house on the east side of Detroit on Mitchell Street. Chapter 22, The House on Mitchell Street. Lord, Lord, Lord. Our house on Mitchell Street was the poorest looking house on the block, containing very little furniture. Pardon me, I gotta take a sip. I know y'all hear my voice getting hoarse. We were just children who knew nothing about the division between social classes due to addresses or zip codes, nor did we care. We loved it. It had 3 bedrooms upstairs where the elder kids slept and 2 bedrooms downstairs. Only 2 of the upstairs bedrooms were usable because the third room had big holes in the walls. The third room where the holes were had such extensive damage that it was actually dangerous. If you looked inside them, you could clearly see through the upstairs portion of the home. Though the room was forbidden, it was the room we chose to play in when our cousins would come to spend the night. Some people might have viewed this as embarrassing, but we didn't. However, it was an adventurous forest for us to get lost in, and we treated it as such. As funny as it may sound, our cousins looked forward to visiting us as well, to play with us inside the holes in the wall. This intensified the game of hide and seek, as you could probably imagine, causing us to have more fun scaring each other due to the darkness inside the walls. It was actually so much fun to us. Looking back, it created great memories. Another memory about Mitchell Street was during that winter when Mama was worried about getting us Christmas gifts. After watching all the toy commercials, making our claims on what we wanted, we couldn't help but be in the Christmas spirit. I remember all of us sitting on the couch, looking out the window onto the rooftops of houses and viewing all of the pretty neighborhood decorations. Mama managed to buy us a Christmas tree, but we didn't have any decorations. We couldn't afford them at the time. The church had given us Christmas stockings filled with goodies, and Mama made popcorn strings for the tree. Television stations celebrated with Christmas programming on nearly every channel, which got us in the mood for singing Christmas songs. They were songs we learned at school and in church, and we sang away. As Mama watched us singing together, an idea hit her, and she suddenly blurted, "Get your coats. We're going Christmas caroling." We'd never done this before, but she got the idea from one of the movies we were watching on television. Mama was buying our toys through a layaway plan and needed money to get them out. She went to the kitchen, came out with this big oatmeal box and a knife in her hand, and slid a hole in the top of the box. We all looked at each other in confusion, wondering what in the world was she doing as she covered the box with aluminum foil. "This box will hold the money we get. It's Christmas time and people are in the spirit to give. Our love gift to them will be Christmas songs," she confidently stated. Though history proves our future would lead us down a musical-driven path, at this time we were just regular kids looking forward to Christmas. You should have seen our faces, ranging from bucked eyes, flushed embarrassment, astonished wide-open mouths, and momentary silence. We replied, "Oh my God, Mama, are you serious?" Bobby and I looked at each other as if to say, "Yeah, she's really serious." All we could think about was how embarrassing this was going to be, and we didn't want to go. We were afraid that our friends from school would see and tease us. We already had to face the ridicule of being half-breeds and walked with our heads down for that. Now we were going to sing Christmas carols to be able to afford our Christmas gifts. What could be worse than this ultimate embarrassment? This caused us to fuss among each other, and Mama heard us. She intervened like a referee at an intense game and told us that Christmas was a season where people had no problems with giving. We heard what she was saying, but we were still leery. We didn't want to take a chance at our peers finding humor in this and feared being the laughingstocks of the neighborhood. Nevertheless, Mama wasn't listening to any of our reasons for not wanting to go. She was our mother and decided that this was the plan. So we did as we were told, put our coats on and left. She reminded us, "You won't be caring about them laughing when you see those presents under the tree." As we were caroling, Bobby and I stood behind Mama and other people who were there singing. Mama kept calling us to come up to where they were walking. However, we lagged behind on purpose because we were scoping the neighborhood, making sure we didn't see anybody we knew. After we'd gone further, a couple of blocks from where we lived, we moved up closer near Mama to sing. We still didn't like it and thought it was a terrible idea until we saw the presents under the tree. It was just like she said. From the Christmas caroling money Mama received, she was able to get our toys out of the layaway. Then Uncle Bill showed up on Christmas Eve with bags of toys and Christmas candy. We had a beautiful Christmas that year, thanks to Mama and Uncle Bill. Once again, Mama found a way to get past her problems. That's our Mama. This was only one of the many examples of what she meant by saying, "Where there's a will, there's a way." Little did we know, this statement would later prove to be a character building lesson for each and every one of us. This would stick with us for years to come, preparing us for Motown. All right. So that was chapter 17 through chapter 22. I'm going to end it on a happy note, on a high note, and not on a low note, because we know a low note in the Debarge family is really low. We don't ever want to end on a low note in this fucking book. Anyway, I have put the link up here. If anybody would like to just click the link and come up and say hello and give your thoughts on what you heard during the readings, any comments on the book, anything, any probably similar experience through friends or something, not sexual abuse, but, you know, anything. I'm going to give you a couple of minutes. What's a good song? Nah, I ain't gonna play another song. I'll just talk for another 2 minutes. Six people, y'all just gonna sit there. You're not even gonna come in the chat and say hello. You had Shady Love sitting up here typing. Nobody even typed to say, hey, Shady Love, how are you? Nothing. Y'all just gonna sit there in the bushes. Oh, don't forget, if you are enjoying The Kept Ones by Bunny Debarge, feel free to cash app Madam Whipass on the $. All proceeds will be going to a stainless steel birdcage for Jumanji and Diva, to Amazon Parrots. And also, still giving you a few moments. You can click the link, or you can just drop down out the bushes and type in the chat and say, hi, Madam Whipass. Thank you for reading. How are you, Madam Whipass? You're just going to sit there in the bushes. You don't think that's kind of rude? I don't even deserve a hello. Nothing, huh? But then again, y'all could be listening from the beginning. You're not even at this point. Oh, well, I tried. Anyway, thank you all for tuning in and stopping by. I greatly appreciate it either way. Y'all have a blessed night. I'll be back again. Peace.